I just wanted to frame that right there. I know you all have coffee back there just in case you're falling asleep.
No,
but I know we're all so spiritual, we never ever are tempted to fall asleep when the word of God is preached, right? Alright, awesome. It's great to have Kutsai with us.
Yeah.
And to have her as a member of the South.
Yeah.
Even though you're in South Africa, of course you have to be in the South region.
Yeah.
Of the London Church. Because
yeah.
Then you'd be close to South Africa by just a few miles. You know, I'm having problems with my voice, so if I cough once in a while or need to take a water break, bear with me. I'm not discouraged, I'm just a little bit challenged. That's all. Let's go to Revelation chapter 12. I don't know if any of us here have ever heard of the Battle of the Bulge.
Oh.
Yeah.
That battle was really the last, you can say, major, it was the last of desperate offensive of Nazi Germany in World War II. It seemed that the fate was imminent, and they tried to give one last shot, so they mustered an army of 450,000 men, combined with tanks and airplanes and everything they had left. And halfway through December 1944, it started, and it ended about a month and a half way through 1945. And it was desperate. They had, the Germans had about 450,000 men. The Allies had about 600,000 men. And after the battle finished, there were about 200,000 casualties. But it was really, it was a desperate attempt by those that were clearly in the wrong. Those that were clearly wanting to spread evil and suffering and desperation upon the rest of the world. There have been many wars, right?
Yeah.
But not every war, most of the wars have not been clear cut who was right or wrong. A lot of times it was just a battle for power, for ego, based on greed. But this war, it was very clear cut. There was a party in the wrong, and there were those who were trying to prevent wrong. So Revelation chapter 12, where we see another battle here. Revelation chapter 12, verse 12. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell in them, but woe to the earth and the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He is filled with fury, for he knows that his time is short. You know, the Bible here says the Satan once upon a time was in heaven, he got kicked out, and he came down to earth. So in heaven, everyone was fired up, because the troublemaker was out. But the trouble was transferred from heaven to earth. And unlike the Battle of the Bulge, it was not a physical battle, where you see tanks and airplanes. Rather, it was and it is a spiritual battle. So therefore today we're going to talk about not the Battle of the Bulge, but the battle for the heart. Because this spiritual battle is really a battle for your heart. For my heart and for your heart. Let's go to John chapter 6. Who yet he really had an impact. Now the man lived to be about 95 years old. He lived into his 90s. And he even had an interview in the early 90s on the David Letterman show. But it's very interesting how sometimes seemingly insignificant decisions can have a huge impact on our life and on our world. Now this man started his journey when actually him living in the States sent his uncle, Sigmund Freud, a box of Cuban cigars as a gift. Sigmund Freud, in return, showing his appreciation, sent him back his general introductory lectures to his philosophy of psychology, which basically comes down to people's behavior are irrational. That people are not rational beings. And you know, as you look in the crowd here, we can all find examples of decisions we've made that are not irrational, can't we? Yeah. And people like Pogo and Mena say, amen. And not only them, but all of us can look back to irrational decisions that we have made. Well, this guy, Edward Bernays, went through these lectures and he, you know, he said, wow, indeed, I'm going to go set out to prove that people a lot of times do not make rational decisions, or rather they make irrational decisions. And so what he did, he changed the world of marketing as we knew it back then. Well, we weren't alive, as they knew it back then. Because back then, people bought according to what they needed. After Renee said, you know what, based on these insights I'm getting here from my uncle, we're not going to have people buy what they need. We're going to be able to change people's perception of what their needs are. And as a result, they're going to buy a lot more. And companies are going to become wealthy. And myself in the process. And so his first experiment was actually with through cigarettes. Now, this brand, I don't think it exists anymore, but back then it was a brand called Lucky Strike. Yeah. Oh, I'm concerned. Too many of you here know that. Oh, no. We have to make sure we check after this. But I know it has to do with your past, right? It's all in the past. It's just memories. That's all it is, nothing else. Well, the guy who at the time was the CEO of Lucky Strike was a guy by the name of Washington Hill. And so Edward Bernays approached Washington and he said, you know what? I am going to prove to you that we can change how the world perceives women who smoke. Because you see, at the time, women who smoked in the open were perceived to be, in fact, what you would call loose women. And so there was great shame associated with a woman smoking out in the public because of the reputation that she got. Well, what he did, he was able to link cigarettes to, at the time, the feminist movement and totally turned around that perception to, if a woman is smoking, it's not because she is loose. It is because she's standing up for her rights. It is because she's associated with the feminist movement. And so that was the first way he actually turned around a market and got many more women into smoking. Well, with this philosophy, he eventually started doing marketing campaigns for car companies, for politicians, for every conceivable thing that was around at the time, and he truly changed people's hearts. Not in a positive way. People became more materialistic. People became more greedy. But he had an impact. You know, he really won people's hearts. awesome miracle. Now, what do you do when someone gives you a lot of free food? You keep following them, right? Because you want to keep having that free food, especially if it tastes good. Now, does that mean that you're loyal to the person? No. You're loyal to the food,
yeah.
Right? So these crowds are following Jesus, and Jesus is preaching the word to them because he's not deceived. He understands, man, these guys are following me because they had their filling. But I want people to follow me not because of what they can get, but just because they love me. Unconditional. When I got married to Maria, for better, and for worse, right? Through sickness and health. And the only thing that can separate us are financial hardships.
No.
The only thing that can separate us is if she burns my meal 3 times in a row.
No.
But if none of those, then when I'm very, very sick, then definitely she should find her happiness elsewhere.
No.
No. The only thing that can separate us is
death.
Nothing else. So see, we understand that commitment.
Yeah.
So is there any surprise that that is what God wants from us?
Yeah.
Of course it's not a surprise. But what does it take to be drawn to God? It's very interesting. John chapter 6. I'm going to start reading here. In verse 43. Okay, so Jesus is preaching the truth, and as usually happens, people start grumbling. 43. Stop grumbling among yourselves. Jesus answered. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. Wow, so it's very interesting. Jesus clearly says, look, the only way anyone can come to me is if he's drawn by the Father. There's just no other way. Now here's the great thing. The Bible clearly teaches that all throughout history, God has been working to what? To align history, whether it, from our perspective, is good or bad, but to align history to give us the best possible chance to seek him.
Yeah.
And in the book of Acts, it said in the formula that we might seek him.
Yeah.
Now, how do companies try to attract us? To tell us exactly what we want to hear. To make false promises, right? Why do you think in every single commercial someone is totally smiling? They will make you believe Colgate is the answer to your problems in life. White teeth will solve everything. Right? Someone else will say that Nescafe is really the solution.
Yeah.
All you need is one cup of Nescafe every day and you will never have problems again. Well, then what do you think is 5 cups? That's true. But the point is, the world knows how to cater to our hearts.
Yeah.
And so in the same way, just as God is moving to get our attention, guess who else is moving to get our hearts? The troublemaker. Exactly.
That was wrong.
Yeah.
And all throughout our lives, we make certain decisions that are crucial and will determine our destiny. You know, the difference between being committed to God and being committed to Satan is God, you can only serve God if you are consciously, totally committed to Him.
Yeah.
But you will serve the darkness whether you know it or not.
Yeah.
You can be actively pursuing it,
yeah,
or not even know what is going on. It is quite okay with the darkness as long as you're not committed God. When I was 15 years old, and I was at home, and my brother who at the time was about 9, he came home and he said, Michael, we've got to go across the street. Cabeas has a gym. And he told me we could work out there. Now, cabeas to Pacimenta means head. And this man, he was well known on the island, and his nickname was Cabeas because he had a big head. He was also a very wealthy man. Now, the way he made his money together with his brother was illegal gambling operations on the island. And he'd been in jail, got out, in jail, got out, and they would always continue with their illegal gambling operations until the authorities were like, boy, this is tiring. And they just let them have their illegal gambling operations. And so I got excited because, you know, I was 15, I was envisioning myself like Arnold Schwarzenegger and big, tough man. So I went to the gym, and I kept going to the gym consistently. It was in his house, but it was all the way on the bottom part, so it was a separate entrance. And he said, yeah, whenever you want to work out here, you can come and go work out there. And as I was working out there, I started to get to know some of his employees. They got to understand that my room, my bedroom window, was facing his house, which was across a very, very narrow street in a very quiet residential area. Barely a car would drive by. And every single night, at about 8:30 to a quarter to 9 at night, you had a huge caravan of about 5, 6, 7, or 8 cars drive up to the house, and they would take out these big bags of paper money and smaller bags full of coins into the house to count. And this guy had a certain reputation. So, but at the same time, I started hearing that, believe it or not, his, you know, every gangster or mobster covers their true source of income, right?
Yeah.
And they usually have a legal operation somewhere through which they whitewash their money. But the operation they have, which is the front of the company, is always legal.
Yeah.
Well, I started hearing that these guys, their real source of money was not something that was illegal, it was something that was even more illegal.
Yeah.
But they used an illegal operation to cover up for an even more illegal operation. Welcome to the Caribbean and Africa. And South America, right?
Yes.
So, while he was known for his gambling operations, I started hearing rumors at school, because everyone knew him, that they were really also into drug trafficking. And at first, I wouldn't believe it. But then, as I started to get their trust, one day I was working out in the gym with Cabeas, and I'm here, a little teenager, with this big, big shot, hot shot on the eye. I was saying, yeah, man, I'm good. And one day he said, you know what? I want you to get your education. You go to university, you study hard, and when you're done, you're going to come work with me.
Oh, wow.
I was like, because by this time, I knew that his gambling operation was just a cover-up. Because I had heard this employee, I would go to the New Year's Eve parties, I would hear the employees talk, and they would drink, and I was like, okay, these guys definitely. And see, we lived on a hill overseeing a harbor on the island that was primarily used for yachts and sailboats. And I had this telescope, which I used to look at the stars, but I also used to look into people's houses. And so one day I was outside with Cabeas, I showed him my telescope, and I showed him how I could look into people's houses. But see, and then, because you gotta remember, we oversaw the harbor, right? And he had several of these, what you call cigar speedboats, the really big speedboats that go very fast. And this is the only time I've seen him angry. He looked at me with a straight, and now he put on his gangster face. And he said, can you see my boats at night? You see, those boats were used to transport all the cocaine and marijuana to South America. said, well, how can I if you don't have any lights on? I said, no. And he dropped the conversation. But see, so this man definitely was involved in drugging. But I was really tempted when he said, you got to study, you got to work hard, and you're going to work. And I said, well, I'm going to do gambling. He said, no, we are going to do everything. And I mean everything. And I knew what he was talking about. He said, we're even going to go into the government. Ooh, wow. But he had a vision for me. He had a plan. Right? And I felt attracted to that. Well, one day at the gym, have you ever met a person that you're like, you have never spoken to him yet out of the work, you're just like, I gotta stay away from this guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, you've never met a guy like the guy I met on this particular day. Because this guy didn't just make you feel concerned, he made you want to get out of there and get out of there quick. I don't remember his name, I only remember that he was overweight. Him and Cabeas and three or four other employees were talking that while I was working out, I just wanted to get out of there because this guy, when you look in his eyes, like he had no soul.
Wow.
It was like he was like a walking dead man. Just empty and just this feeling of evil that oozed out of him. Like heartless and no mercy whatsoever. Well, I never forget this guy. But I finished the work and I got out of there and I said, I never ever want to see this guy again. Well, fast forward a year or two. I'm going to the drive-in. And this guy, I'm not watching the movie for my car, but rather I went to sit somewhere. And this guy came to sit next to me. This is like a scene out of like a movie like The Godfather. This is like unreal. So this guy sits next to me, and I start, you know, I'm 15, or at that time I think I was 17, and I'm kind of showing off how awesome this player I know, and again, yeah, I know what that is. And he was like, oh, really? Yeah, you know the fireworks show that he did yesterday? I'm the one who wants to shut the fireworks. Because he should be giving his fireworks shows on January the 1st. And people would be lined along the street, crowds of people, for him to give his fireworks show. And I was there in the car with them, with again a caravan of about 10 cars. And we would go by the ocean to shoot these fireworks. And I was really feeling really great about myself. And so I told this guy, and the guy, oh, interesting. And then he started telling me a story how he used to work for Cabez. He was one of his men. Not in the illegal gambling operation, but the more illegal drug operation. And he started telling me that something was wrong with Cabez, and Cabez shut off all the channels he had to get his drugs from South America. To then continue shipping them to Europe or the United States. But then he said to me, he said, you know what? You are young. You have a future. Sounds like my dad talks. You're young, you have a future. Here's what you need to do. You need to continue gaining his trust. And then when you are more powerful than him, you cut him off, you get rid of him. And then you are the one in control. And you know, when he was telling me this, now you understand why I felt like a scene from The Godfather movie. Yeah. You know, I was just, I didn't even dare look at him. I just looked straight ahead and said, what have I got in my hand? By that time, I didn't feel so hot anymore. I started to realize, okay, this stuff has consequences. And so, about 15, 30 seconds after he finished saying that, I looked at him. And he was gone. I looked behind him, I looked around, the guy was disappeared. Gone. I was like, is this for real? I mean, this is just like out of a movie.
Yeah.
But it really happened. Now, I later went on to study in the States. Cabez, a few years later, died of a heart attack. But the last time I saw him was about half a year before he died. I was on vacation in Curacao. chicken to share my faith with you. And half a year later, he died. But you see, there was a battle for my heart.
Yeah.
Now, if I would have decided to go into the direction, there's only one way out, and that is dying. That's what they say, right? You get into that world, there's only one way out. You got to die. But you know, it's no different in the spiritual world. There's only one way out of the darkness, and that is to die to yourself.
Yes.
Right? So the underworld understands. If you want out, you have to die.
Yes.
They understand that principle. God says, if you want to be saved, you got to die to yourself every single day.
Yes.
Amen.
But really, that is how you get life.
Yes.
Because the things that you die for are literally the things that will kill you anyway.
Yes.
Those are the things that will ruin a relationship.
Yes.
Those are the things that will harden your heart.
Yes.
Those are the things that will get you into debt. Those are the things where you enjoy now and pay later.
Yes.
God says, pay now and enjoy later.
Yes.
But irrational as we are, what do we usually go for? Enjoy now and pay later.
Yeah.
Even though we know the interest is painful.
Yeah.
But that's how us irrational beings operate. And so that's why Jesus says, no one can come to him unless the Father enables him. Let's go to Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Now God has set in place certain laws. Right? We have the laws of physics, right? What is one of the laws of physics if you're on planet Earth? Everything that goes up must go down. Yes. It would be very strange if everything that comes down must go up. No, that's exactly the opposite. Right? Equal and opposite reaction. One of the laws that has to do with force. And so, a smart guy like Arnie can give you a lot more of these laws of physics because he's a physicist. Right? But in the same way, there are spiritual laws that we cannot escape. As a matter of fact, sometimes we just get ticked off, why are these laws here? Because we want to have our cake and eat it too. We want to spin it up and not have consequences. We want to not serve God, but yet have a fulfilled life.
Yeah.
But those things go against the spiritual laws that are all around us. And so I mean, that's why some people just get ticked off at God. Because they feel trapped in this world where they cannot do as they want to do. Well, let's look at one of those spiritual laws. You ready for it?
Yeah.
Chapter 3, that's right. You see, and God has put these laws in place. Number one, that's who he is. But number two, for us to come to our senses and to start making rational decisions, not irrational decisions. Just give me a chance to get there myself. You know, and then you start talking about, well, what is the meaning of life? Anyone ever ask themselves, what is the meaning of life?
Yeah.
You know, exactly. When you're very young, the meaning of life is getting that toy that you really want to have. Right? When you're really young, the meaning of life is getting home on time to watch that TV program. Or have your parents help you stay up late enough to watch that TV program. You know, when you're young, the meaning of life is, why do I have to go to bed so early and all my friends at school can stay up so late? But as you get older, you realize that it's not as simple as that, correct? So Ecclesiastes chapter 3, you have King Solomon, who at this stage is going and he's trying everything on earth, everything his heart desires, he's giving you. In order to see what in the world is going to give me the satisfaction that I am looking for.
Wow.
Not unlike today. poor could gain from his toil. I have seen the burden God has laid on men. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He also set eternity in the hearts of men, that they can offend them what God has done from beginning to end. So, wow. The Bible says that God has set eternity into the hearts of men. And has he not done that? Do people not wonder about what is my life about? Do people not wonder about the purpose of life? How many people do not fear death?
Yeah.
Now, if death just meant you're eaten by worms or you're cremated and that is the end, well, there's not so much to worry about.
Yeah,
I had a conversation with a colleague a few weeks ago, and I don't know what we were talking, but eventually, I said something to her, well, I really admire you that you're not afraid of death. And she admitted she's petrified of God. Mm. Because God has set eternity in the hearts of men. So we're always looking for that meaning, we're always looking for that purpose. But yet there's only one place that we can really find it. Let's read verse 18. I also thought, as for men, God tests them so that they may see that they are like animals. Wow, this is very encouraging. God says, think of yourself like an animal. Well, what is he talking about? Man's faith is like that of the animals. The same faith awaits them both. As one dies, so dies the other. So it doesn't matter how many toys you have. It doesn't matter how many toys you owe people. In the end, we all die. Right? I remember 30 years ago or so, I saw this sticker in the States that said, he who dies with the most toys wins. In other words, the wealthier you are, you're just winning and frankly lying. Well, a few years later, I saw another sticker. He who dies with the most toys still dies. I think the second one is more accurate. Wouldn't you agree? So God has put us in this situation that we just cannot escape that. He said, okay, I have shut all doors, every single door that you may think you can walk through. I shut them all so that only one leads to what you actually need.
Yeah.
See, like Edward Bernay, we are made believe that we need so many things. But there's only one thing we need, and that's a relationship with God.
Amen.
We are made to believe that we need wealth. We are made to believe we need this relationship. And a lot of times these things will compete for our attention with God. Because we are deceived by Satan's marketing. And he is an expert marketer. He knows exactly the strengths of our heart that he needs to pull, right? Well, let's go to Matthew chapter 13. Well, whose hearts are constantly pulled at by God as well as by the world? You want to know? Because sometimes we think, well, I'm a baptized disciple, so I am good. Well, it's kind of like graduation from university. Everyone is celebrating, but most people wake up the next day to a rude awakening.
Yeah.
This is not the end, this is just the beginning. Because I graduated, but guess what? Now I have to start paying off those loans. Right? Now I gotta actually find a job that makes enough to pay off these loans. So I thought pulling an all-nighter was tough. Oh my goodness, how I wish I could go back to pulling off all-nighters. To get this degree. And so it's just the beginning. And so in the same way, when we get baptized, yes, we have repented, right?
Yeah.
We've repented of many things. But it is just the beginning.
Yeah.
Where God says, okay, now you've repented of all the obvious sins. That is awesome. Your sins are forgiven. That is cranking. But now we're going to work a little bit on that character of yours. Yes, that is very painful. Now we're going to work a little bit on that how lazy you can be. How greedy you can be. How tied you are to your money. And guess what? When something has been a part of you for a long time and God is trying to rip it away, how does that feel? Painful. When you have a bandage on a wound. Now the bandage, if you leave it on a little bit longer, it becomes part of you. And now you pull it off and it hurts. And you're tempted to say, forget it. Let me just get out of here. But God says, no. This is just the beginning. We're just starting out. But if you persevere, you're going to see God's promises unlike you could have ever imagined.
Amen.
But see, you've got to persevere through God pulling off that bandage of your skin. But in this case, not your skin, your heart.
Yeah.
Where God is healing you from all the things in your heart that should not be there, because they will end up killing you in the end anyway. So Matthew 13, verse 24. Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. When the wheat sprouted and formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, sir, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from? An enemy did this, he replied. The servants asked him, do you want us to go and pull them up? You know, that deal with our knowledge.
Yeah.
No, he answered. Because while you're pulling the weeds, you may root out the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. At that time I will tell the harvesters, first collect the weeds and tie them in bundles to be burned, then gather the wheat and bring them into my barn. So what we see here is that we can be in the kingdom physically, but be totally deceived of where we are at. Right? So when we get baptized, it's just the beginning. That's interesting, because God here says, or the Master says, this stuff happened while you were sleeping. Okay, well, how can we be sleeping? Well, a couple of ways. One, we can be sleeping spiritually, when we're studying the Bible with someone, just going through the motions, and then we baptize and we're fired up, but we didn't really make a disciple. Because we just went through the studies, but the heart was not moved. Right? There's another way we can be sleeping. Someone was baptized as zealous and passionate, so about disciple. But then we were sleeping in our discipling times. Or we didn't have discipling times. Or our discipling times became times of psychology. We decided to imitate Edward Baines. And instead of using the Word of God, we use certain marketing principles. And now someone could look good on the outside, but in the inside they are being transformed into something that's not right. And on Judgment Day, it will all be exposed. You know, a few days ago I realized, man, I'm getting really sick here. And you know, when you're sick, it's a little bit more of a challenge to have your quiet time, right?
Yeah.
And I've been preaching, I've been discipling, no matter what, you got to have your time with God first thing in the day.
Yeah.
And Wednesday, I actually said, no matter how beat up you are, I said, oh my goodness.
Beat up, bro.
I didn't know I was going to beat up a few days down the road. And then I got beat up, and I said, okay, Mr. Big Shot, what are you going to do now? Preaching and discipling boldly what people need to do now that the rubber hit the road, what are you going to do?
Yeah.
And I was like, man, it's challenging.
Yeah.
You know, to wake up in the morning, have a good quiet time, and you're not feeling well at all.
Yeah.
struggle to have a very basic, good, quiet time. Not even to talk about being stoned deep, being left for dead, and walking back into the city the next day. It's like, oh my, as I make this, I am so far from where I need to be and from where I can be. But you know what? It just exposed where I'm at. It just exposed how I need to push and grow and persevere. Last Sunday I was talking to someone that I discipled, and he said, and this particular brother has had a hard time with his quietness. Not in London, he's somewhere else. And he's been having his quiet times consistently, and then Sunday, it was a free day, it was Monday, which was also a free day there, as it was a free day here last Monday. And he said, no, today I really had to sleep. And I said, no, Michael, today, no. I said, no, I have to get my rest. And then later I can have my time with God. Wrong. See, we've got to instill a conviction. There is a battle for our hearts.
Yeah.
Right? And there are a lot of things that want to influence us.
Yeah.
But ultimately, only one thing will give us what we really need. Not what we are made to believe that we need. But that we really need. And there is an unconditional relationship with God based on an unconditional love for God.
Yeah.
Everything else is temporary.
Yeah.
Only this will last. And in closing, I want to share two scriptures really quick. Luke chapter 2. You mean, you're asking me, you're telling me it's not good enough to have a great week? I mean, having a great day is challenging enough. Having a great week, I can see, but you want to do like this my whole life? That is just too much. I need to have my freedom to enjoy myself. Make believe you need what you don't really need. So in Luke chapter 2, Jesus was, how old when he was in the temple? 12. Right? And in Luke chapter 2, verse 12, Luke chapter 2, verse 52. Let's see what it says here. So everyone was impressed and said how awesome Jesus was. And at the age of 12 it says, and Jesus grew in wisdom and stature, and in favor with God and men. What's the implication? As awesome as he was when he was 12, he was not there yet. He still had to grow in wisdom. He still had to grow, perhaps even in identity, in the conviction of what his destiny would be. Now go to 1 Peter chapter 1. What was Jesus, how much space, how much room did he have for margin of error? Well, that sounds pretty good, but we're going to have everything confirmed with Scripture. Amen? So 1 Peter chapter 1. We see how much pressure Jesus felt to, as we call it, perform. Right? 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from your empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers. Oh my goodness. This scripture is still applicable today. Empty way of life of your forefathers. But with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. The most challenging teaching command that Jesus gave us must be perfect, therefore as your heavenly Father is perfect. No pressure, right? No sweat. We will make sure we do our daily, you know, Hail Mary prayer, whatever the case may be, and we should be okay to go. Absolutely not. We are expected, there will be ever be a force, we will not. But can we fight and strive to be there? Yes, we can. So I want to leave you one final challenge. Today, whether you are a disciple who's doing well, who's not doing so well, or if you're not a disciple, I give you this challenge today. From today, pull out all the stops. Pull out all the stops. Whatever is preventing you from growing, pull it out. Be open about it, pull out all the stops so that you can love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Well, after hearing the word of God being preached, are you ready to stand up for Jesus?